Hi students, very good evening to one and all. In continuation to my lecture on Paradise Lost, today I want to focus on one of the important issues of Paradise Lost, that is to consider Paradise Lost as an epic poem that follows all the conventions of, or many of the conventions of the epic poem, which are called simply as epic conventions. Okay, today this lecture will be focused on the epic conventions of the poem. So Paradise Lost is an epic, as we have been discussing all these days. And an epic is defined as a long narrative poem with universal themes of universal interest. So to say that epic Paradise Lost is having all the characters of epic poem, epic conventions, following the epic conventions. Conventions are nothing but norms that are followed, okay, usually or in a tradition or in a given culture. And all epic poets have been following those traditions. That is why they are called as conventions. And conventions are the formal generic characteristics. Generic means pertaining to this genre, that is epic. Formal characteristics. So an epic poem will be having many of the formal conventions, which I'll be listing, and the notes for this topic I'll be sharing you through the WhatsApp group, so don't worry. And this is one important aspect, because you may get it as an essay questions to write about the epic conventions in the poem Paradise Lost with reference to book one. Or you may be asked as, consider Paradise Lost as an epic. So in that, for that question also, you can add that epic Paradise Lost can be considered as an epic because it follows many of the epic conventions along with the loftiness of the theme and the universal interest, universal nature of the themes dealt in the poem. So first of these conventions is in medias res. This is a Latin phrase. A Latin phrase that means in the middle of things. The convention generally is that epic poems, not only epic poems, in Greek tradition, even dramas used to begin in the middle of the action, or maybe to the to a point before conclusion also, to some extent. And epic convention is that the poem begins in the middle of the action, the overall action of the poem that is intended. So we have to see whether Paradise Lost, of course, fulfills this characteristic or not. Yes, it fulfills, because this example for the medias res, the example is there in the book one itself, because the book one begins in the middle of the action, where after the war, after the impious war that was that went on in the heaven between God and Satan and his followers, after the war, after the completion of the war, the Satan is defeated and he is thrown out of the heaven. We know that. So there the action of the book one begins. This can be termed as in medias res. So that means in the middle of the things. So after the war, in the middle of the story, after the war, the Paradise Lost is began by Milton. So the convention, of course, the first convention, that is in medias res, which is followed by many of the epic poets, either in Greek or Latin, etc., is followed by Milton also. Then the second convention is invocation. In fact, to this I referred while explaining the text also. Naturally, epic poets invocate the muse. Muse is the Greek goddess of poetry. And one more thing is, usually previous ancient days, Homer and Virgil, Homer's Iliad, Virgil's Aeneid, are the two Greek ancient epics. And those days, epics are recited for the audience. So when they start recitation, okay, when they begin the recitation, usually poets pray to gods. This is called as invocation. And even in written epics, the tradition is continued. You go to Fairy Queen, that is written by Spencer, okay, Edmund Spencer, whose two poems you are familiar with. You can just Google and read a few lines of Spencer's Fairy Queen, the beginning lines, where the muse is invocated, as we could find in epic poem, that is Paradise Lost, book 1. Here, the uniqueness of Milton's style in invocating, actually, Milton, though, uses the word muse, later he gradually goes to the invocation of the Holy Spirit. In coherence with the theme in his hand, which is a Christian theological theme of the fall of man, narrating the fall of man and how he was restored, etc. So, he begins with Sing Muse, but later, if we go to those 1 to 16 lines, actually, invocation and of course the next convention also comes, invocation, we could see how he addresses Holy Spirit, where he says, "Thou brooding, sitting on the vast abyss, thou art there from the beginning, and nothing is hidden from your knowledge," etc. He writes. So this is the invocation of the muse, but it is the Holy Spirit. When we come to Milton's epic, it is Holy Spirit. So the second convention is also fulfilled. That is the invocation of the muse or the Holy Spirit, as you could see in the beginning lines of Paradise Lost. Okay, then the third convention, the third epic convention is statement of the theme, which is called as proposition. Okay, making a statement, proposition. Okay, is making a statement. Some people call this as exposition also. That is, before we read the whole poem, we'll come to know the subject of the poem or theme of the poem, which the poet himself states for us, makes a statement, a clear cut statement of what his theme is going to be. Okay, and classical epics of course begin with this statement of the theme. And Milton in Paradise Lost of course has gone a step forward. He did not state his theme alone in the proposition, but he also wrote about what he is going to achieve, or what is his aim, what the aim of the poem is, that is epic. What is the aim behind writing this epic? That also Milton states in the proposition. Wherein he states that to assert eternal providence and justify the ways of God to man. So that is how he states the theme of the poem, which is the proposition, and also the aim of the poem. The whole sole aim of writing this epic is to assert the eternal providence and justify the ways of God to man. Of course, we have elaborately discussed the historical, theological, intellectual context of writing Milton's Paradise Lost, in what context he wrote it. And of course, we could say that Milton was successful in asserting his aim and also incorporating all his ideas about the eternal providence, and also how man can seek God. That also he did. So the third convention is the statement of the theme, otherwise proposition or exposition, which of course lets us know to know the theme as well as the aim of the poem. Okay, then fourth one is stock epithets, using stock epithets for describing. Okay, the epithet is an adjective that describes the quality of a particular character. And Milton's Paradise Lost, of course, uses this, and he not only uses simply one or two words as epithet, but in book 4 he has an elaborate epithet when Adam describes Eve. And of course, one word epithets, we can see how he names Satan, archangel, archfiend, infernal serpent, etc. Like that, those also we can consider as adjectives, which of course Milton uses to describe the character, that is Satan. And then we have long formal speeches. Of course, Paradise Lost book 1 fulfills this convention very much. Book 1 itself fulfills. Of course, in other books we may find some more, because we have, I think, 5 or 6 speeches of Saturn, which of course while explaining the text, I kept on referring to that this is the first speech, second speech, etc. So long formal speeches, using or incorporating long formal speeches into the text, is one of the conventions. This is the fifth convention, and the Paradise Lost fulfills this convention, as the book 1 abounds in long speeches of Saturn especially. Okay, and actually Saturn gives a long speech here in the book that is prescribed, and in book 4 of course we will find Adam giving long speeches, Eve giving long speeches, and so forth. Okay, so incorporating long speeches, by incorporating long speeches, Saturn of course gives the epic quality, intensifies the epic quality of the poem Paradise Lost. And so the fifth convention is also fulfilled. Then this is epic divine intervention. Divine intervention is actually the presence of the supernatural element. Of course, we will feel the presence of the supernatural element even in book 1 when the poet says that Saturn could get out of the fiery lake, though he was chained, okay, adamantine chains, he says, chains which cannot be broken, which can never be broken, yet Saturn manages to get out of the fiery gulf, that is only because of God's will. So the indirectly Saturn shows the intervention of the divine element, that is God. And of course in other books we can see how Adam and Eve, who were seduced by Saturn, were rescued, or the paradise is again revived for them only because of the intervention of the Son of God, who comes to the earth and sacrifices his life. So in the epics, the divine intervention, God's intervention, divine intervention, it means God's intervention, because without the intervention of God, there may not be any solution. So for the fall of man, if God never intervenes, there may not be any solution according to the Christian theology. And so the epic as a convention, of course, follows this convention of bringing in the divine elements into the poem, and Paradise Lost, of course, fulfills this also. And then the epic digressions are there. Epic digressions are actually passages that do not further the action of the story. See, in book one, we have after Satan addresses the fallen angels, there is an elaborate description of fallen angels who have become gods on earth after the earth is created. So this, of course, can be considered as an epic digression, because there is no development of the story or action of the story, just for providing the list of the heathen gods or fallen angels who converted themselves to be the gods for heathens in different places, at different places in the world. Of course, that is another characteristic of epic or convention of epic, which of course gives or provides an elaborate list of characters, okay, in a different manner. So the seventh convention is epic digressions, and this also is followed by Milton in the epic that is Paradise Lost. Okay, next we have a very vast setting. So epic, of course, sets in the vastness of time as well as space. Okay, so the time is, we can't say, that is before the genesis of the earth, and it begins from the alpha, the beginning. It begins from the beginning, that means the alpha. And then of course, it is the space is the whole universe, because it is, if we keep the word Christian aside also, it speaks about human fall, okay, and then revival. So that is also can also be considered as universal in space and time. You know, temporal and spatial vastness is one of the epic conventions, and of course Milton's Paradise Lost fulfills this also. This is eighth. And then you have grandiose elevated style. This is what I actually mentioned in the previous lecture. Okay, this Milton, how Milton made his style grandiose, of course, which was the cause of criticism also. Because many people have criticized Milton, but that for that style which is very ornate. And of course, Eliot, who is a very popular poet and critic of the 20th century of English literature, of course, derides him, saying that it is very unnatural. Yet there are some critics who supported that this is the requirement as the genre, that is epic, is concerned, because epic poem demands that grand style. So the grand style, of course, is there in the ornateness, okay, baroque ornateness, and then the unique way of, you know, presenting things in an elevated language. And Milton's Paradise Lost, of course, the line, one line, you know, long is the way and hard that out of hell leads up to light. That line might persuade us to entertain the possibility that Milton deliberately made his epics language difficult. Naturally, epics language is very difficult. You might have also observed or understood that, because before this we have read Chaucer, we have read Spencer, and we read sonnets, and then can metaphysical poets, etc. And of course, epic as a genre. This is the first you are reading, and epics, of course, are huge, long narrative poems, which of course will be composed in difficult style only. And the grand style of Milton, of course, can be asked as a short answer question also. A style that is using complex sentences and that is very ornated. That means with the similes, metaphors, etc. And also the lines filled with heavy theological or other thematic concerns or concepts. You know, in between the lines, we may find many concepts that Milton reveals, okay, in some phrases, etc. So, this convention is also followed in The Paradise Lost by Milton. And then, a definitive meter. Usually, epic poems follow a definitive meter. And in this also, I have touched upon in my previous lecture, where Milton used blank verse, that means unrhymed verse, you know, without any rhyme scheme, because he never wanted to use the rhyme scheme. And this blank verse is also called as heroic verse. Okay, it is as if it is suitable for the heroic themes that are dealt in epic poems. And also it follows the iambic pentameter. Within the lines, it is iambic pentameter. And sometimes to the last words ending with monosyllabic words, tough monosyllabic words. So this is how epic Paradise Lost, of course, fulfills the epic conventions of definitive meter. Of course, it is iambic pentameter. Unrhymed iambic pentameter. He wrote in that, and it is also called as heroic meter. Okay. Then epic battles, portraying the epic battles or describing the epic battles is one of the conventions, 9th or 10th, I think. And this also is fulfilled in the context of Paradise Lost, because Milton describes the a war between God and Saturn. The wars are considered to be heroic. Okay. And they reveal the heroic feature of the epic poems, and that is why it is always followed. And Milton, of course, though he also included this convention, mocks at this convention of describing the battles in book 9. However, he of course describes the war between the fallen angels and God. That also, and also Adam and Eve's temptation by the serpent in Eden. So that battle also he describes in book 9, I think. And next convention is epic simile. This I have been referring to in my lecture of Paradise Lost and in the previous lecture also. A simile, what you know, is a figure of speech which is comparing someone or something. Comparing to something, okay? Or someone, or to something else. This is simile. Similes are metaphors or any other figure of speech is usually incorporated into the text to make it more effective. So in the Paradise Lost, you have a big simile of Milton comparing the fallen angels to the autumn leaves, and then dead corpses or wheels, chariot wheels, etc., that are floating on the Red Sea, when Pharaoh was chasing the Israelites who were released from slavery under the leadership of Moses, etc. So like you have an epic simile running for many lines. It is only to describe the number of fallen angels. So epic similes are there at many places in book one itself. So you can make a list of those epic similes when you read. At least if you get a question on epic similes, you should be able to quote one or at least three or four epic similes so that you will get more marks. Now quoting the text as it is, you know, quoting means quoting only, literally. You have to put quotation marks and write as it is in the poem. You should not change anything. For that you have to by heart say 4 or 5 lines or 6 lines, whatever it is, and then you have to reproduce it in the essay that you will be writing as answer for any question that you are writing. This is for the poetry paper. For poetry, you have to by heart some lines of the poem about which you are answering. So epic similes, incorporating epic similes into the writing of the text or the poem is the convention, say 10th convention of epic poem. And Milton of course fulfills this convention very well. And as instance, you have many examples in book one itself. So then 11th of course is a very common thing, that is the didactic nature of the poem, that is epic poem. So the didactic nature means actually teaching us moral, as in the proposition or the aim. What is the aim behind writing this poem that Milton has already stated, that to justify the ways of God to men. And so it turns to be a didactic, moral. He wants to teach some moral to the human being. And of course, epics are mostly written from this point of view, because they should try to reform the whole race of human beings. Universal. It is universal, didactic, applying to all human beings. And then you have another epic convention besides didactic nature, that is after epic, you know, descent into the underworld. This of course you can very well guess. The underworld for us in the book one is hell, the hell. So the narrator of the poem goes into the hell as if he has been to the hell and has witnessed every place, every nook and corner of the hell, the place which we are named, which is named as hell. And the description, visionary description or imagery, okay, full of images, a description full of images, visions, etc. So this description of the underworld or descent of the underworld is the epic quality or convention, and this is also fulfilled by Milton in writing the epic, that is Paradise Lost. So I hope, I think I have given you a dozen of epic conventions. Of course, when you write the answer for the question in examinations, you may not be mentioning all, explaining all this, but you can list out all this and explain, say, 6 or 7 important conventions. And then say how it is represented in stating in the poem that is prescribed for your study. So I hope you will be listening to this lecture, and I'll be sending you the notes also. Better you keep the notes open and then listen to the lecture, you will understand. Okay, have a nice time.